And this is your morning news update for April 6th. So glad you could join us. The Democratic Labour Party has its eyes set on the election of a new president set for May 1. Last evening, the party's organs held closed-door talks, which, according to interim president Steve Blackett, set a solid foundation for a new leader to replace Verla DePisa, who stepped down after the January 19 general elections. Nominations for a new president end on Sunday.
Four persons so far have been nominated by the branches. We still have a few branch meetings to be held this Sunday, and that will round off the branch general meetings.
Mm-hmm.
That will round off all of them, and then from there we'll know whose name will actually go on the ballot. After Sunday, all of the candidates that were nominated will be formally written, and once their response in the affirmative, it is at that point then we can announce to the public who the prospective candidates are, the nominated candidates are. But we will want to get, because the branches can nominate some person that you have to understand that the branches can nominate some person who may not be interested in being president. Yeah?
Right.
So once that process is finished, next Sunday the 10th, the secretariat then will write formally to those candidates who have been nominated from among the 30 constituency branches. And once the person writes back, we'll give them a cutoff point. Once they respond to us in that time limit that they are interested, then we can announce who then are the true candidates.
Meanwhile, Blackett says the party has moved on from government's offer of 2 Senate seats, a constitutional amendment that would have allowed the DLP, the party with the second highest votes in the recent election to join the upper chamber, failed to attract the necessary support. Blackett tells Barbados Today the party is content with the president's choosing of the 2 remaining senators.
As far as we know, according to the constitution, because the amendment was not made, we've gone back now to what the status quo was prior to the amendment being made, and that is where the governor general, the president, that is, can choose 9 senators rather than her 7, 2 additional ones to represent the opposition. And that is where it is at now. I think the ball, as far as we are concerned, the Democratic Labour Party, we return to what the status quo was prior to the attempted amendment. And it is now squarely in the province of the the president. So, as far as we're concerned, that is where it is at. And the amendments, as far as we're concerned, is a dead issue. We have moved on from there.
Rising COVID-19 infections will not affect face-to-face classes. Deputy Chief Medical Officer Dr. Anton Best told a national COVID-19 update last evening that while there has been some cases in the schools, the infections remain low and there's no need for concern at this stage.
We have analyzed the data from the 21st of February when the schools resumed face-to-face classes, and I'm not at liberty to say what that information is. We simply don't have the clearances yet. But the number is relatively small when you take into consideration what is happening in the community. So this is what we anticipated. We did anticipate that we would pick up a few cases in the schools, but we're not seeing sustained transmission happening within the schools because the protocols are working.
The Speightstown Jetty is back in operation after a $1.2 million restoration project. It was commissioned at a special ceremony on Tuesday evening. Acting Tourism Minister Kurt Humphrey believes the jetty will deliver big dividends for the northern city.
And it signals the possibilities for even greater accessibility to Speightstown and the north via water taxis, and holds the potential to bring new life to the community with expanded opportunities for fisher folk, for restaurant and bars, retail shops and others, for those in leisure and commercial sailing and marine recreation. It will bring increased human traffic that will enhance the prospects for economic viability for this area.
Member of Parliament for St. Peter, Colin Jordan, welcomed the return of the jetty and stressed that it was for the people of St. Peter.
The Speightstown Jetty is for the people of St. Peter. The Speightstown Jetty is not for any particular group or class. It is for the people of Speightstown, the people of St. Peter, and the people of Barbados. And that, I am saying here at the commissioning, because that needs to be reinforced, as far as I'm concerned, or in my mind, it needs to be reinforced. The commercial component will be important for residents and businesses in this town. And so we expect that just as the jetties from the 17th and 18th century provided that economic activity that brought benefit to the residents and to the country generally, we expect that the jetty, now being recommissioned, will also bring business possibilities, business benefits, commercial benefits to all stakeholders who are associated with Speightstown.
There's regional and international news after this short break.
More oxygen means more energy, means more adventure. Cure Oxygen, natural spring water infused with more oxygen to improve your energy, immunity, and performance. The next generation of hydration. Cure Oxygen, nature's ultimate water.
Caribbean Cool is a refreshing juice drink that contains 100% vitamin C that you can enjoy any time of the day. It has a refreshingly awesome range of Caribbean flavors. Mulberry, orange, fruit punch, pineapple, sorrel, and pineapple coconut. Suitable for any occasion. Caribbean Cool.
Welcome back to Regional News. Guyana's President Irfan Ali is concerned about critical labor shortages. He says the country needs more people and his government intends to attract more people to Guyana.
We need people badly. And we need them now. And with the type of infrastructure that we're investing in, the type of healthcare service we're investing, the type of educational services that we're investing in, guess what? Those services, when they're fully built out, in 5 years to 10 years, will require people to consume the service. So we have to work on a massive agenda now to drive this population up and drive it up rapidly. So not only to encourage members of the diaspora to come back quickly, but to also to work out a strategy as to how we will deal with labor. I had a meeting on Friday with the contractors. And they're all behind schedule now because they can't find labor. They can't find workers. And this is a major problem that we're going to be faced with.
On the international front, Shanghai will remain on lockdown as Chinese authorities review COVID-19 test results for the city's entire population of 26 million. But some are angry at officials for separating COVID-19 positive children from their parents. Al Jazeera's Adrian Brown reports.
China's financial center has been like this for 9 days. The scenes in Shanghai reminiscent of those 2 years ago in Wuhan, where COVID-19 was first detected. During a mass testing of its 26 million citizens, which has now concluded, officials reported a surge in local asymptomatic cases. Medical workers from across the country have been pouring into the metropolis to help. The success of this mass mobilization will partly determine when Shanghai can reopen or for how much longer it'll remain shut. What is clear is that the government is still not prepared to follow other countries by living with COVID-19, says one prominent Chinese commentator.
Overall, China is the only country in the world today which still pursues this zero policy. And I think eventually China will be the winner. China is on the winning side rather than on the losing side.
But that policy means separating children from parents if they test positive, a practice that has raised anxiety levels among local as well as expatriate families. State media's responding to the widespread criticism of the practice. This report, with a soothing soundtrack, appears to show parents and children who've tested positive being admitted to an isolation facility. But it's unclear if that means the policy's been scrapped.
That's news, but for the very latest, visit our website at www.barbadostoday.bb. You can also subscribe to our e-paper, email updates, or like us on Facebook, and sign up for our breaking news alerts via WhatsApp.
We're also on Izumi Media and bus terminals, as well as Screenplay at supermarkets and gas stations near you. You can also hear us on Mix 96.9 FM and Capital Media HD 99.3 FM.